Good morning. We have with us Major Sunil Shetty, a veteran, an entrepreneur, and a founder of AskMentor, My Startup TV, and he's also an alumni from 93 batch from Osmani University, Journalism and Mass Communication. Good morning, sir. Welcome to our J-Hub.
Thank you.
Sir, as we know, you're already from, you have done your journalism from Osmani University. So how's your journey from here and to today? Please tell us about
it. Yeah, so I basically completed my journalism in two parts. That was, what I mean by that is, when I started off, I got into journalism after my graduation, completing my graduation. And when I was about to finish journalism, so without, I had submitted all the projects, but I didn't write the exam, because by the time I had gotten to army. So there was a gap of 2 years thereafter. So I came back after 2 years and wrote my exams. So though I am a batch from 93, but I could complete in 95. But then what doing this course did to me was, it laid a great foundation, as you know, so I could learn the basics of journalism, you know, how journalism works, you know, how reporters work. And as I was interested in writing, and those days it was only print, there was no radio in the department, nor there was television as you have now, so it was print. So I learned more about print. And what I did when I joined the army, I ended up writing a book on the regiment I got commissioned into.
Okay,
so I continued my journalism back, you know, my journey. But when I left army in 2000 and I came out, I was very clear that I had to go back to journalism. Yes. Because after army, if something gave me adrenaline rush, was journalism. Okay, so I said I can relate myself to journalism. I came back, I came out, and then I said, okay, what do I do next? So I took up a master's course in London from City University, and I did a course in radio journalism. And that was the second phase of my getting into journalism, or closer to journalism. And that also opened up doors to reach to Afghanistan for a certain assignment with the media. And then eventually got into entrepreneurship, and that led to me coming to India. When I came back to India, I decided to connect the dots, you know, with my background of journalism, entrepreneurship, and while I was in Afghanistan, I was also mentoring people. So all these three things together gave birth to AskMentor and My Startup TV, which I'm recently launched, which is an exclusive channel for startups in India.
So you said there was a gap between 93, completing journalism. What made you enter into like army? Like, there was any specific reason, or it was your interest?
See, I was always interested in joining army, coming from the armed forces background. My father, my grandfather, we all served in the armed forces, right? So grandfather from my mother's side. So it was very natural for me to get attracted towards armed forces. And during my graduation days, I was also doing NCC. So basically it meant, you know, I was very clear I wanted to get into armed forces. But writing, because I enjoyed writing, so there was a gap between the period I finished my graduation and joining army. So those days, you know, you had to appear in the entrance exams. So I got my, so I had a choice of joining MBA versus BCJ. Okay, those days that the MBA was just taking off.
Okay,
people were more opting more towards joining MBA. But I was like, no, I want to go into journalism. So I got into journalism. So that's basically how it happened. So I got into journalism, and just before I was about to complete, I got my army call and I joined army.
Wow. So you said you did your master's in London as well. So how is different from India? And it's a different country.
Yeah.
So what makes a difference from India and the other country? Please.
Wow, that's a good question, and a lot of differences. One of the things is the stress on, or the importance given to practical work. Like when I was here, it was more theory based, right? And anyway, because it's print, so you could only do so much. We used to have one new university paper coming out. I don't know if it still comes out. So
yes,
it still comes out. So you used to have a Osmani University paper or something, which used to come, I think, once in 3 months. But during our tenure here as a student, I think only once we printed that. Okay, whereas while I was doing a master's in London, every day we had to work as you're working in a journalism, as a journalist, right? So radio, the university radio would go live at a certain time. So you had to go out, apart from attending all your classes, you have to find a report, pitch it to your, you know, editor who would be your professor, and go out, bring the story, come back, edit it on your system, and then give it to the radio, okay, through this university station, and then it would be broadcasted. And most time you had to do it yourself. So you would go record or interview or do a feature, come back, and then go on to the radio station, and then, you know, play the report. So you had to do everything. So there was like, there wasn't a single day where you would not doing it. And deadline, if you miss the deadline, your report is gone. So all your effort that you put in is gone if you don't make it on that bulletin time, right? So it was, the pressures were still as you would actually work in journalism. So that helped me when I went to Afghanistan. So I was working for various news agencies. Like I worked for Associated Press for television as a freelancer, mostly freelancers. I worked for Kuwait News Agency. I did some small work for UNI. But the pressure, well, I already understood what it is. So there was a deadline you had to, you know, submit. So that is a major difference, I would say. That even now, you know, recently I've been interacting with some private colleges in Hyderabad. I don't want to name them, but what I realized was the insistence on doing practical work with deadline is missing. So the students would do something and there is no deadline to meet, so it kind of continues, and so there is no motivation, because unless you have a pressure on you as a journalist, because as a journalist you have to do that, right? With now live reporting coming in, yes, it's become even more difficult. You have to come up with a story now.
Yes.
Okay, it's not even, you don't have 30 minutes to wait for it, right? So I think that's the major difference in our education system, where we are not insisting on the practical side of it, actually going and doing it. And not just that, coming back and filing it within the deadline. And as a reporter, if you miss the deadline and your story doesn't get played, I think that's the worst feeling, you know. You work so much and your story doesn't get carried. That's the worst feeling as a journalist you could have. Mm-hmm. You know, it's like a batsman, you know, getting out at 99. You know, you've done all the great work, you come up to 99 and you're out, you know. So that's the same feeling you would have, actually. I've been a cricketer also, so I understand how that feels. You know, if you're out at 49 or 99, and it's the worst feeling. As a reporter, same thing. You miss a deadline, you've done all the work and it's gone. So I think that's the major difference, I would say.
So you said you've been also in Afghanistan. So what made you go there? Like, if it was a part of the journalism or was it your personal interest?
No, okay, that's a different story. And basically, the way I ended up there was I wanted to, so again, as I said, practical, right? So as part of your degree, you have to present certain theses, mm-hmm, which we also have it, right? And apart from that, because I was doing radio journalism, you also had to do a documentary.
Okay.
Okay, so there's a written part and also radio, okay? And you had to pick the live subjects, the current subjects. So you can't go back into a library, look for an old topic and kind of just build on it. It doesn't work like that. So a lot of people were picking up subjects, and I was from the army, and I was reading a news article at that point of time, which said, you know, that Afghanistan is going to, the international forces are going to, there's a NATO, are going to help rebuild a 70,000 strong Afghan army. So I was like, wow, as an army guy, I know that number 70,000, what it means. And building a, you know, an army of 70,000 strong, new from the scratch, is a challenging task. So what happened is I said, wow, let me see, you know, what are the challenges? Can the country actually build that? So I proposed this as part of my thesis, that I would do a documentary which would cover the challenges of building an Afghan army,
yes,
rebuilding an Afghan army. That was my topic. And as luck would have it, the day I went to present the topic for my thesis, I saw a notice board which said, you know, there is a, the universities have a competition where they give away some awards, cash awards, for people who come up with great ideas for thesis,
okay,
for covering that. Okay, so the money can be used only for doing that part. So I said, oh, okay, let me submit this. So I submitted my idea there. What happened was, as luck would have it, I got picked. Sort of the 70 odd people who submitted on it, the 5 got picked. So mine was one of it. So when I went for the interview, it was called Neon's Brochure. So when they called me, they said, we like your idea. Now we would like to know, how would you do it? Would you go to Afghanistan? I said, yeah, obviously I will go to Afghanistan. They said, but do you understand, you know, the country has just, you know, Taliban have been just kicked out. It's immediately after 9/11.
Yes, yes.
You know, they said, the US troops are still moving in, right? And how would you do it? I said, that's what I'm training for as a journalist, right? I'm supposed to be going to places like this, not be away from it. If I'm going to be a reporter, and the other thing was, in our journalism subject, we had something called conflict reporting. Okay, so one of the things, and I was, being from the armed forces, conflict reporting was natural, you know, it was a natural affinity for me, you know, it was drawing me close. And I said, that's where I want to be at some stage, do conflict reporting. And as luck would have it, for the first time in the history of Neon's Brochure, they actually gave more than, so usually they divide that money into four or five students, but this time they gave me 50% of the money.
Oh.
They said, we want to give you 50%, we want you to go to Afghanistan and do the report. And I took that money, I went to Afghanistan, so I was supposed to be there for 1 week. So I used that money for paying my translator, hiring a translator. I couldn't stay anywhere with that money, but I stayed in a Gurdwara, okay, Sikh Gurdwara temple, right? And so I used that money to stay there, food, travel, ticket. I bought a ticket with that. This is, I'm talking about 2001.
Okay.
So, £600 I got from them, okay. Not a lot of money, but I spent about £400 on ticket and £100 on my translator, and £100 was for my food, okay. So, I stayed there for a week. And as luck would have it, on the last day of my stay there, I ran into an organization called Internews. It was a US funded project for media,
okay.
building new media. So they were training journalists and they were doing many stuff. So the director offered me a job. He said, when would you like to join us and work with us? And I said, why not? You know. So when I went back to London, okay. I wrote my exam. I didn't even wait for my graduation, I didn't even wait for the results. Next day I just picked up my bag, the last paper, I picked my bag, came to Afghanistan. And I stayed there for 12 years, straight years.
Wow. So, coming back to your startup TV, what is this startup ecosystem? I mean, who plays this important role in it?
See, startup ecosystem basically has multiple players, okay? One, obviously the entrepreneurs, okay? The second are, if you take Hyderabad as an example, okay, so there would be incubators, accelerators, okay, then you also have angel investors in the ecosystem, okay, you have mentors in the ecosystem, and very typical for Indian environment, one particular force that nobody talks about is the parents. I would very much add parents into the ecosystem. This you would not hear anywhere, but my experience of 5 years, and also as a student when I was in college, to now when I'm in the system for 5 years, ecosystem, Hyderabad ecosystem, parents play a great role, actually, critical role. So, an ecosystem is basically a place where, not necessarily in one place, but kind of spread out. So, what does it involve? Who are the players that involves? So, the entrepreneurs, aspiring entrepreneurs, I want to start my own business. So, I'm part of it, right? So, next what happens? I need to have my own money, or I need to generate the seed fund from close friends or family. Right? They're also part of the ecosystem. Then once I reach a certain level, I need to be either incubated at a place, like you have T-Hub here, okay, Hyderabad, government's thing, okay, it's a incubation center. So, it could be an incubation center, there could be an accelerator next one. So, what happens is, once the startup reaches a certain place, you know, there are accelerators who have got far better facilities from where you can be accelerated faster. So, thereafter you also have angel investors into it, you have mentors into it. So, there are a lot of people who form, you know, part of the ecosystem. One person, as I said, who are always missed out is the parents, but I think they are very important to the startup ecosystem. But at the end of the day, it's the parents who let most people, you know, take the call. Yes, you can go. Because I've been mentoring a lot of startups, and every time I face these challenges, parents kind of put their foot down and say, no, we want you to take up a job, right? And especially I see it's very prevalent among female entrepreneurs, you know, women who want to become entrepreneurs from the college, right? They want to get into entrepreneurship. Parents have played a critical role. So I think they also need to be looked into as a part of the ecosystem.
So, you have been in this field for 5 years in Hyderabad, right? So, what do you think, what is like, in, I mean, especially in Hyderabad, around across the India, especially in Hyderabad, what do you think, the what is the contribution of, how they are contributing in building an entrepreneurship, like in the startup ecosystem?
So, as I said, you know, each the angel investors, you know, they are the ones who are actually funding it.
Mm-hmm.
But I'll let me take one step back and say Hyderabad, unfortunately, the ecosystem is not matured enough.
Exactly.
Okay, it's heated up too fast.
Hmm.
What I mean by that is, you know, it was in 2015 when I was talking about, when I started AskMentor, when I was talking about startups and mentorship, very few people understood. Okay, but fast forward 2016, there are mentors all around. Okay, like I remember 2015. Searching on LinkedIn, mentors in Hyderabad, I couldn't find many. At least in the profile, mentor word wasn't there. But 2016, almost pretty much everybody was a mentor then. You know, and worst part was, most of these mentors were coming from corporate world. So, it's if you have never played cricket, but let me give an analogy, right? If you never played cricket, how can you coach?
Exactly.
Just because I have been watching cricket all my life does not make me a coach.
Yes.
I should have played cricket at some level. So most of the people from MNC who have always worked in an air-conditioned office, guaranteed getting a check at the end of the month, they became mentors for entrepreneurs. See, they can be mentor but domain experts only.
Yes.
So if I'm working for Microsoft, let's say if I want to be a mentor, yes, the domain expertise I have, I can teach that or I can help them understand that. But how would I ever work with an entrepreneur on entrepreneurship when I have never been an entrepreneur myself? So start, Hyderabad was notorious for that. Most of the entrepreneurs were corporate. There was a term which was used by somebody called corporate dropout. So people who were in corporate, left the corporate world, started doing something else, they became mentors. Then there were all these fake angel investors, right? And people with 1 lakh rupees in their pocket became angel investors. The reason for this was they were, you know, it was giving them instant, you know, stardom on social media. So you could go to, the moment you told yourself as angel investor, you put the word, you know, prefix or suffix to your name as angel investor or as mentor. So you start getting invited to colleges for giving delivering lectures. You started getting, you know, all the Facebook posts because poor students in the college don't understand it. So I would go and declare. A person A would go and declare himself as angel investor and, you know, appear in 2-3 events and that's about it. They get invited for colleges, they were on social media, they became superstars and that's, today you see, they are not there. Where have they gone?
Yes.
You know, angel investors don't, I mean, it's like, where are the angel investors gone today? They all gone vanished, right?
Yes.
I mean, I'm not saying all of them, but many of them have gone, right? Similar to mentors. They were, every second person you came across was a mentor. But where are they gone today? So, Hyderabad ecosystem that way heated up very fast. Okay, I think the startup ecosystem probably required a few years to build. Instead, it built up what the journey which should have taken about 3-4 years. Okay, it kind of happened. That kind of thing happened in a year or two, and that heated up very fast. And the reason the net outcome of that was. In 2016, 17, you know, rather 17, the bubble burst, and all of a sudden everything was gone.
Yes. So, as you said, you mentored many people. Like, how was your experience? Like, what were the expectations that people who those who came to you? What were their expectations? And what were like? You said you they need the ecosystem, the finances, the angel. So, how was it? Like what you did or what was their expectation and your guidance to them?
Okay, one of the biggest challenge with most people who heard about entrepreneurship and startup were college students,
mm-hmm.
right? Most of them. So the only stories they heard was you have an idea and somebody is giving you money, right?
Yes.
That were the stories.
Yes.
So then the word called unicorn, you know, then somebody raising $1 million. Somebody reaching a valuation of $10 million, $20 million, $100 million. So all these college students, aspiring entrepreneurs or entrepreneurs as I call them, they were only hearing these stories. So they thought, if I have an idea, I approach somebody and that person is going to write a check and give it to me. So people would come to me and say, yeah, your Ask Mentor, great. So they would never bother asking, what do you do? We have an idea, can you fund it? Even I get today. On LinkedIn, people send me, you know, a pitch deck and say, you know, we want a crore rupees for this idea. Yeah, great. Please go and find it. It doesn't work like that, you know. So that was one of the things that would happen. They would come to you and they would ask for fund. Okay. And many of them, just with the idea, they have not gone out the ground. They have not done any work to find out whether the idea works, doesn't work. And everybody thinks there's a unique idea they have got, which is wrong, because what you are thinking, probably there are other 100 people out there thinking about the same idea. So that was the biggest challenge, I would say. You know, we found people come to you only thinking that they have an idea, they'll get paid for it, or they can raise some fund on that.
You're already saying that there were many startups events till a few years ago. Now most of them are almost gone, like especially the big events like August Fest. So what do you think, how is this affect the startup entrepreneurship environment? Yeah. You say,
see, that is the irony, right? In between 2015 16 17, there are too many events. Pretty much almost every month there used to be an event.
Yes.
Okay, sometimes even two events, and big events like August Fest, Tech in, I think it was called Tech Fest, and all were there. But now, if you see, it has gone to the other extreme. Very few startup events are there.
Yes.
Now it has affected, because one is the students who are there in the colleges, you know, they don't have access to an event like this where they can go and interact or network.
Mm.
So it's definitely affecting the aspiring entrepreneurs, right? The other is, it was all these events also provided an opportunity for startups to display, you know, their own product or their service or the startup idea they were working on.
Yes.
So to that extent, I think, you know, they're losing out on that. The students who are there either in their final year or working on their startup idea, or those who have already come out of the colleges and working on their startup idea, I think that part is definitely affecting them. So we have moved from one extreme, one at the end of the spectrum where it was too much, to the other extreme where too few. So, you know, somewhere I think there needs to be a balance, that there should be enough events through the year, definitely some big event like the August Fest, which brought some great international speakers. And I personally believe, you know, some event like that, you know, at least the state government should, you know, support them to bring event like that back. Because these events provided young entrepreneurs and startups an opportunity to, you know, network and interact with international audience. So it was great.
Yeah. So what do you think this events like this August Fest and events is almost vanishing?
Mm.
So what could be the reason behind it? There were a lot of events and fest.
Yes.
As you said just now.
Mm.
But what could be the reason for them to vanish in a, you know, speedy manner?
Yeah. See, at least I have interacted with, you know, some of these big event organizers. None of them were profitable. None of them were making enough money, at least what I was told. So for them to continue doing this was a challenge, because to bring in, just imagine this, the kind of logistics it takes, right? Getting 10, 15, 20 speakers from across the world, pay for the tickets, you know, bring them in, make them stay in a hotel.
Mm.
Okay, now that will be a minimum 5-star hotel.
Yes.
Take care of their, you know, expenses for that one day, even if they're coming for one day. Then booking a huge auditorium or a convention hall, right, with all the other advertising it goes through, create promotions around them, right? And most of the people coming there would be, you know, you have to cater for their requirements. So the people attending these would pay and buy tickets, but that would never meet the cost. It's like cricket match again, because
yes,
we Indians understand cricket match so well. Imagine if you had to do all these big tournaments without sponsorships.
Yeah.
Tickets, sale of tickets alone cannot meet all the cost, right? So I think through these big events, organizers, that was the major challenge, that they were not able to meet the cost of organizing these big events purely from ticket sale. And governments, I don't think even way back in 2015, 16, 17, governments were supporting them. You know, with a little bit of support from the government, probably these events could have continued. And at least big event like Tech Fest and August Fest should have been there, if not the small events.
So you already you brought the name up, I mean government role into it. How do you think government can play a role in this starting up, or what do you think how can the government can help these events to go up or rise, or the help the this ecosystem? How do you think that the government can have any role, any kind of role, or what kind of role it can play?
So the government is currently, the government is always supporting by, so if you talk about central government, the Stand Up India program, they already have something, okay, where last year, till last year, there was this startup yatra going on, right, where teams would visit different parts of the country, and in each ecosystem, they would conduct pitching events, mm-hmm. First training event, and that pitching event, and they would pick up ideas from there, bring them to a central platform. Just to give example of Telangana, so I was invited to one of the sessions as part of the Telangana Yatra. So they would go into districts.
Okay.
They would find people with great ideas, bring them. They brought them to Hyderabad in JNTU. So the final pitching event was there, and from that pitching event, they picked top 20 startups, and the government was to fund them 25,000 to 50,000 rupees. But here's the downfall. What I heard from some of the startups who won, mm-hmm. Those who were part of the first 20, top 20 startup ideas, apparently, as I was told to me, the event finished last year in November, they got money somewhere in this year.
Oh.
So most of the students, most of the startup ideas are gone.
Yes.
So government need to reduce that gap, you know, if they really want the startups coming from districts and all, where the pressure as it is there to get into some job after you finish your graduation, and if the waiting period for, you know, getting that money, the seed money, you know, 6 months plus, they're not going to be there. So something needs to happen. So the startup yatra itself need to be fine tuned. Coming to our state in particular, Telangana, I think, you know, we could have, firstly, there is a need to create awareness about what startup journey involves. That's the first and foremost thing. So to that extent, I think government should bring in, make this as part of the curriculum itself, right from 8th, 9th standards. These generation kids are very, you know, very smart. They're brilliant. Yeah. They would understand. At least getting them an exposure of what it involves. I mean, first we have to get that, you know, we have to demystify it by saying, by making them understand that startup is not easy, yeah. Okay, it's not all glamorous, and it's not that you have an idea, you'll get money.
Yes.
So that needs, so they need to understand, same as an 8th grader or a 9th grader, 10th grader knows what is the, what kind of effort goes into becoming a doctor or engineer.
Yes.
Right?
Exactly.
Same amount of, you know, understanding they need to have about entrepreneurship. So government need to make this as a curriculum to start at very early stage, right at the school level. The second thing is, probably a good idea is to have a bus yatra, you know, which goes around all the districts of Telangana and doing, you know, not only creating awareness, but finding out what the ideas are, you know, and instead of waiting and bringing them to Hyderabad and creating something here, you know, we need to find ideas which are practical. I want to share one brilliant idea I thought should have been part of the 20 list was, there was a group of young girls, mostly Muslim girls, and they came with an idea where they said, we want to start all women sports club.
Wow.
Okay, in our district. Now, so I was like, wow, that's really great, you know, and I have been investing in startups. I said, you know, I would be happy to be part of this. So I said, I asked them, so what makes you think that this will work? So these girls were very clear. They said, listen, we are in a district, okay, there's no place for girls like us, okay, young women like us, to go to, especially as Muslim girls, to go to after our college hours.
Yes.
So where do we hang around? And because they are from the new generation, they can't be sitting at the home all the time. So they said, if we had a place, a small place, where we would all, you know, gather and play some games. So I asked them, what kind of games would you like to play? So a pool table, maybe a card game, a board games, carom board, dart shooting. So they were talking about doing small things. I said, okay, great. Even if you were to get the money to set it up, how would it sustain? They said, well, most of these girls who are coming would come here, would pay for it, a monthly subscription. So I thought that was a great idea, but never got picked up.
Yes.
In the yatra, right? So instead of chasing unrealistic startup ideas, okay, which because I want to share this here. One of the idea was about making an aircraft engine. Okay. Will HAL buy that engine? Will not. And will 50,000 make that happen? No. Could not. Instead, if this idea was picked up, probably in 50,000 those group of girls were actually launched something which was doable,
yes,
on the ground.
Yes.
So we need to understand that, you know, instead of thinking, right now when they talk about startup, we only can think of Ola's, Uber, Oyo Rooms, you know, Swiggy.
Yes.
It need not be. There can be only so many. It's like, again, let me give an example of cricket. There could be only one Sachin Tendulkar and one Virat Kohli. And now Rohit Sharma, right?
Yes.
In a, when you have a team of 11, not everybody will be a, you know, perform at par with a star player. Startups also will not become, every startup that idea that comes about does not become a unicorn.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
So to me personally, when I think of it, when you look at a startup, if it can create, you know, two employments, three employment, that startup idea is great. Because at district level, if there's a startup idea which can create few employments, okay, and run on its own without having to borrow money from anywhere, you know, create, sustain, can sustain, that's a great idea. So one is create awareness at the school level about the challenges it takes or the hard work it takes to become an entrepreneur through curriculum. Second is to have something like a bus idea which can go on a yatra,
mm-hmm.
Find great ideas, fund them there itself.
Yes.
You know, don't wait for them to again come back to Hyderabad and the whole journey takes another 6-8 months.
Yes.
Okay, find great ideas there itself, you know, vetted by some experienced entrepreneurs. Let them launch and let it not, don't chase, third is don't chase big ideas only. Even a small idea like these girls wanted to do a, you know, girls, all girls club.
Yes.
Great idea.
Yes.
So I think these are three things that needs to be done.
So you are talking about ideas in general, like, not in general, it's an important thing of any startup or any entrepreneurship. What do you think the idea comes from? Like the nowadays generation are like, when they are completing the degree or the PG level, they all think that we, instead of going into the job, we should do a great job.
Hmm.
I mean, a great business, we will be a, like a good thing. So this idea, do you think that the idea itself has to be a separate class kind of a thing, or there has to be some mentor to give them an idea to how to get a practical ideas on that?
Well, idea is okay. So there is nowhere to give it, nobody will tell you how to get an idea.
Yes.
Okay.
Exactly.
Because usually ideas come either out of your own experience,
mm.
that you felt something, or you see an opportunity. Okay. But one can definitely be, you know, at your college or school level, one can always, you know, make them understand how to spot opportunities.
Yes.
How to spot opportunities and how to turn those opportunities into a business idea and then probably roll it out as a business. That is possible. That's doable through a proper mentorship program.
So coming back to Hyderabad, why Hyderabad hasn't seen any unicorn startup or any successful startup emerge from the city or the state? What is your idea on that?
Well, I think our ecosystem is still in a development kind of stage, right? And we have got a very few handful of incubators here. And one of the complaints that I always have about the government incubator, which is the T-Hub, is it is not very friendly in terms of people approachable, you know?
Okay.
Aspiring entrepreneurs approaching them and talking to them. Because I do get a lot of people who come to me, and one of the times whenever I bring up this point that why don't you go to T-Hub and talk to them? So most times the general complaint is we can't even go through the, you know, go past the security. So the environment that Hyderabad needs is something which is approachable.
Yes.
You know, students should be able to reach out to place like T-Hub and say, I have an idea, can I talk to some mentor? Or I want to get into entrepreneurship, what can I do? So this is the first part. And coming to the question of why we don't have it, I think we will have it eventually. We'll reach that point because a lot of great startups are working right now, you know, and they're doing some great job.
Mm.
So, like one I can name is Cargo Exchange. It's a very unique logistics startup, and they're doing a great job. It is just a matter of time and they will reach. So I think it will take a couple of years more, we will reach there.
So many professional colleges have incubation cell and entrepreneur cell. How is the role towards building startup ecosystem?
Zero. They are only doing it. I have interacted with multiple colleges.
Yes.
Most of them are doing it because they want those NAC accreditation, especially the engineering colleges I'm talking about. And they have beautiful infrastructure, but when it comes to a vision, they have none. And I was invited to like AskMentor was invited by some of the colleges. They only want you to sign an MOU. Just sign an MOU so they can then present along with their accreditation, for getting the accreditation of NAC, okay? And thereafter, that's about it. And what happens is, for most of these places, if you go and ask them what is the structure they have, or how are they planning to get their students who are interested in entrepreneurship to the next level, they don't have a structure. So they have beautiful infrastructure, but I don't think they have a structure. They have a plan for it now.
Okay. We were talking about the angel investor, sir. So the angel investor and mentor are critical part of any ecosystems. How are our own angel investor and mentoring contributing towards the development of ecosystem, sir?
So I already answered a part of it.
Yes.
Initially, that most of them are pseudo investors and
yes.
pseudo and fake angel investors. There are a few angel investors. There are some platforms like Hyderabad Angels and all, which are doing a great job. They're investing into it. But the standalone angel investors and standalone mentors, I don't know what is their contribution. There is nothing visible to be seen. There are many who claim to be angel investors and mentors between 2014 and 2017, early 18, and many of them have vanished now.
Yes.
So I don't think they have contributed much to the standalone investors and standalone mentors. I don't think they have contributed much to the ecosystem.
So is the startup ecosystem culture designed to meet the requirement of aspiring entrepreneurs, like especially those in the colleges? What do you think? Is there anything?
Our ecosystem, no. At this point in time, it is not designed for students in colleges or schools.
Okay.
As I said, there should be a place where these students should be able to go and ask, huh. or at least express that I have an idea, what do I do? Or how do I build it? Or I want to be an entrepreneur. It's like what happens when I want to become a cricketer, what would you say? Find a coaching academy,
yes.
right?
Yes.
You go to a coaching academy, the coach there would say, okay, what is that your interest is? Right? You want to be a batsman, bowler, and if you want to be batsman, what? Bowler, what? Where is that happening in entrepreneurship? Okay. Where would they go to?
Yes.
Colleges don't have it because in college, they have somebody for recruitment, but do they have somebody to take care of the entrepreneurship? And even if they have, okay, they're not entrepreneurs. Right? They've never been entrepreneurs themselves. So how would they, how would they advise them?
Exactly.
So most of these colleges need to have something like a visiting entrepreneur who would come there, spend probably, once in a month at least, if not every week. They could have two or three of them. Alternatively, people could come every week and then the students can go to them and talk to them. That way it will, that will help them. But I don't think today we have that system.
So the recent death of Vijay Siddharth has exposed the underbelly of business world. How will it impact the motivation of young entrepreneurs and especially aspiring entrepreneurs?
Oh yes, when the news came out of his death, not just the aspiring and the young entrepreneurs, even seasoned entrepreneurs. So I'm part of a group called The Group, THE. It is The Hyderabad Entrepreneurs Group. And I wrote an article also recently for a Australian New Zealand based startup platform on the same subject. The entrepreneurs were quite shaken. It's not because, the way he died, but the very fact that, a seasoned entrepreneur like him, snapped. So it is true that entrepreneurship is not easy.
Yes.
Okay. Ask any doctor or a medical student. It's difficult, right? So as I said in my previous comment, that people think I have an idea, I would go in there, I get money and I start building the business.
Yes.
Some get lucky, they actually find money because the ideas were great and people paid, gave them money and they build up the business. Now once you start building, how fast will you build? Think of, imagine building, you know, multi-story building. If the real estate guy starts building, you know, every day starts adding one floor, someday it will collapse.
Yes.
You know, because it's not ready to
yes.
take the next floor.
Yes.
You know, there is seasoning period in a construction, 21 days, right?
Yes.
So entrepreneurship is same. There's time required to build or scale as you go forward. Now, his death actually created a lot of, it created a lot of discussion among and debate among the entrepreneurs, right? And all kind of opinions came about. You know, right now we are not even, I'm not talking about whether, you know, what decisions he did wrong, okay,
mm-hmm.
or right, or what was the debt on his head. All that is, you know, a different subject for a different day. But the pressures that entrepreneurs undergo,
yes.
you know, even if you're successful, and when I say successful, not as in, you know, making millions of dollars every month, even if you're running your business successfully, big or small, doesn't matter, but there's a pressure always. Right? Pressure towards your employees that you have to pay every month, you have to have enough money to pay them salaries, run the business.
Mm.
Pressure towards investors if you have taken money, you know,
yeah.
they're looking for you to scale up. Pressure towards your own family, you know. So this has to be understood by, you know, aspiring entrepreneurs. That's why I said, it has to start at a very young age at college.
Yes.
Like when you are appearing for MBBS, MCET exam, you know you have to work for 5 years. Out of which 4 years are going to be day and night, 18 hours a day,
yes.
right? And just by having an MBBS degree does not take you anywhere. You have to again add another 5 years, 2 years of post-graduation and super specialization. Something like that has to be understood by the students at the college, school level about entrepreneurship also. That's not about having an idea. If you're lucky, you get some money. That does not make you successful.
Yes.
You have to continuously work over it for 8 to 10 years to build a successful business. Even then, like in the case of Siddhartha, you know, things can go wrong. So once you're prepared for it, once you know how, you know, what it involves, what are the challenges to it, I think you are much better prepared for it.
So already we have spoken about the government role. If you have to give any advice to the government of Telangana, what would your suggestion to them building on the startup culture in Telangana apart from whatever you spoke?
See, apart from what I said, I think one is, if they could, I mean, definitely, you know, I'll just repeat what I said because they are the key ones. One is, you know, is there a way they could help restart at least the two big events that Hyderabad saw, the August Fest and the Tech Fest? Apart from that, if there is a way, they, you know, one yatra could be done regularly going around. AskMentor
yes.
would be very happy to be part of it, you know, where you go into the districts and, you know, find the ideas and help them build it, you know. And then last but not the least, is there a way we can create awareness right at the school level, college level, junior college level, you know, about entrepreneurship. So anybody who is aspiring to be an entrepreneur knows what it involves. So those are the things I think to start with could be the ones government can do.
Okay. So there is T-Hub in how do you rate their performance since its inception? Like what role is it playing building the startup culture?
I think T-Hub, you know, so way back I had, I think, made this comment that if you watch Star Trek, right, so there is this mothership, right,
yes.
Star Trek has a mothership and there are small ships which work outside, okay, so if there is anything they come back and, you know, log into the mothership and then, you know, whatever needs to be done. I think T-Hub should act as a mothership, okay, and it should have multiple small ships outside. Like say, for example, AskMentor, right, where we could go scout, look for great ideas, great startups who are already working and find a great one. And whenever we find a great one, they get sent to the mothership.
Yes.
That way, I think the way T-Hub is working, their efficiency would, I mean, the chances of them bringing out better startups will improve. So I think that's what they should do. At this point in time, they have every year, I think every few months or year, they graduate a number of students, a number of startups out of that.
Yes.
We don't know where they go. Okay. I think in the first phase, they had about 500 startups. We don't know what happened to most of them. Now they have some startups. We don't know where they're going. I can understand, you know, getting started from this, building a startup from the scratch as T Hub is a challenge, right? Instead, if they could bank on by collaborating with all the other incubation centers and accelerators and find the best ones and bring it to them, because they have great resource and backing of the state government. If they use that the right way, I think they can. We could have multiple successful startups coming out of our state.
So, least not the last, I want to know, as a AskMentor, you are already in the AskMentor. When people come to you, like for a mentoring, and do you give any additional, suggestion, as if it doesn't work, their idea doesn't work, is there any second way to go with it?
So, as AskMentor, we don't have a concept of, 6 months or 3 months. Okay, most accelerators and incubations work like that. You know, you are there with them for 6 months and then you move out. We don't have that concept. That's why we don't work as an incubation center. We don't work as an accelerator. What we do is, when our startups come to us, right now we have some startups. Okay, we work with them as long as it's required them to be mentored.
Okay.
So some of the startups with us are for about 3 years now.
Wow.
Okay, some of the startups are there for about 2 years. So we come, and yes, some startups fall off. It happens every time. But we engage with them over an extended period of time, because in this journey, as I said, it's not 1 year journey. It's about 8 to 10 years journey.
Yes.
And the first critical 3 years is very important. So we want to, that's why we want to be, involved with them as long as possible. So 3 years is minimum you have to be. And we have, most of the time we're working with them is for 3 years right now. And so we involve in all phases, which includes, if they're going for a pitching event, we would look at their pitch decks. If they're going to meet some investors, if they need us to go with them, we'll go with them. We've attended multiple rounds of investor meets for some of our startups. So we went there with them so that, it helps them, close the decision-making process faster. That's what it helps. So we work for an extended period of time.
So how you help in the decision-making? That was my main question.
Yeah. So we don't see... As a mentor, you don't tell them that do this or do that. You spread out all the options in front of them. So you list out all the options and you say, okay, this is what will take you here. This is what takes you here. Ultimately, the call is of the entrepreneur.
Yes.
Right? So, because we all understand cricket well, coming back to the cricket as an analogy, a coach can teach you how to play, the right way of playing straight drive. But it's ultimately the batsman has to play based on the ball the way he sees it or he understands it. Same is here. That we can tell them what are the things that can happen or how does it look. Finally, it's the call of the entrepreneur.
Thank you, sir, for visiting here. It was a great experience talking to you. We came to know a lot about startup entrepreneurs. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.